Hi, welcome to the Town TV studios. Here I am, sitting in front of these bank of computers and TV screens. It's where Jason normally sits and makes a show for you. But anyway, got a great show this week. We were at the opening of the Cafe Med in Salisbury. That's Salisbury's new trendy cafe. We're also at the sad retirement of the Humphries family in Andover. That's the jewellers. Tony was down there. I was down in Westbury in Wiltshire. That was amazing fun, driving the new Marcos LM500. We bring you that on the show. That's 170 miles an hour. It's amazing. Curry with Murray, I've got down here. I think Jason came up with that title. Tony, I went to Union Street in Andover to find out how you make a real Indian curry. Not one of these packet jobs, a real Indian curry. Reg was down at Avebury talking about UFOs. That's really interesting. And Tony's off today to look at a dormouse. I don't even know, dormice or dormouse are becoming extinct. And we had this news report through, and he's gone over to Winchester to find out what's going on. Anyway, I think the Cafe Med's just about coming up right now. So thanks for watching Town TV. Don't forget to call us on Andover 390-390 or Salisbury 555-222 with all your news stories. Thanks for watching. Take it away, Jess. If you've been watching Town TV, you think all we do is go to all the first nights of everywhere, which of course is what we do. We get paid for it too, don't we?
We certainly do, and I hope you all appreciate it out there, the hard work that we go through to bring you these events. I mean,
where would you be on a Friday night? In the Cafe Med in Salisbury, drinking glasses of champagne? Of course you would. And that's exactly what we're doing. We've come to the opening night of the Cafe Med. Where is it?
Castle Street in Salisbury.
Castle Street in Salisbury. Hope you enjoyed all the mayhem last week with Sense and Sensibility. That was wonderful, wasn't it?
Which I wasn't invited to.
That's right. But you were invited to the Salisbury Leisure Centre.
I certainly was, and it was an excellent night. Yeah. And I hope it raised lots of money for the Olympic team.
This is Phamie McDonald, if you didn't know.
You know who I am. You know who I was.
Exactly, yes. So, right.
Right.
Are you going to take your champagne?
Oh, yes.
Jason's going to follow us.
Yes.
And we're going in there to speak to Richard Smithson. He's the owner of the Cafe Med.
Yes.
See what's going on. So, after you. See you in there. Richard, how are you?
I'm very well, thank you.
Thank you for inviting Town TV tonight.
It's a pleasure. Welcome to Cafe Med. Lovely to see you.
Superb, isn't it? I mean, you turned it around very quickly. It used to be called Just Brahms.
Just Brahms. We've turned it around in a couple of weeks with a Mediterranean flavour, taste of the sun. I'd like to bring something new to Salisbury and exciting. We've got a French base of a menu with fish specialities. And what I want people to do is to come in and relax the atmosphere. And I want them to come in. They can come in for a drink. We've got this wine bar area. Come and have a starter if they want, or a full meal. So treat it as they want, like a French cafe.
So fantastic. What do you think of this place?
I think it's absolutely wonderful. I've had a beautiful glass of champagne. This is opening night. What have you got on offer for the buffet? I've seen some plates of food going around.
We've got some lamb kofta, salmon en croûte, tomato and mozzarella salad. But fishes, we don't major on fish. We've got some fish soup speciality, which is one of our dishes, because you've got to come and try.
Brilliant. Do you think we'll get in the kitchen in a minute and just have a little look?
Yes, absolutely.
Just a little peep before you start getting busy.
Yeah. Should we do that?
Yeah. And you've got lots of famous people here tonight, I believe.
We
got here tonight?
We have a treat for all you girls out there.
Right, Reg?
Have a look at this. Hello.
Go ahead, sorry.
Isn't he just the perfect Gillette man? Hello.
Hello, darling. How are you?
What are you doing here tonight?
I'm drinking.
Is this what you do regularly?
Huh?
Is this what you do regularly?
No, I don't drink regularly. I'm too old. My kidneys they suffer a bit. No, I came here to support Rich because I think he's done a great job. And as well as you're here. So obviously, hopefully you think he's done a good job as well, right? And what are you up to?
We're just running about, drinking champagne, filming people and seeing what's going on and having a good time. As
rate?
We always do.
How do you rate? You got champagne, I get red wine.
We're television, you know, darling. Of course we get champagne.
So
I hear you're an actor. What are you working on at the moment?
Well,
what have you been working on? What's the last thing?
I just got off Mission Impossible, which is a new Tom Cruise release. And then I'm just discussing with Wesley Snipes a new film.
Wow.
It's interesting for a spring, but we're not quite sure. So the motion picture deals are quite interesting, so don't worry about that stuff. And then I'm in development with LWT, which is London Weekend Television, on a project that I actually wrote. So I'm actually quite busy.
Now, listen, I hear a rumor. I hear a rumor.
Yeah, go ahead.
Somebody told me this.
Yeah, yeah.
Stop me if it's not true.
Yeah, I'll go.
Are you the Sugar Puffs man?
No, I'm not the sugar puffs man. Who said that?
Somebody told me. A little bird told me.
This is ridiculous.
A little honey monster told me.
No, I am not a honey monster. I'm not a honey monster. Honey monster is much bigger, actually.
Well, I thought you were quite large. I thought it could be.
Actually, I know who the honey monster is, but I'm not going to let out the secret. No, I did do an ad for honey monsters, and we had a lovely time. Shot it down in South Africa. And but that's it. I usually try to keep that quiet. I'm telling you.
We've let the secret out now, and you shall never.
You didn't ask me about Heather. No.
Oh God. Okay, well, have a good time. Keep on
Thank
drinking.
Thank you very much.
And hopefully we'll see you later.
Thanks. Bye.
Let's go find some more people.
I recognise Gail from the Baker's Arms.
Oh, it's Gail.
She's famous. Hello, Gail. What are you doing?
Yes, sorry.
What are you doing here?
Excuse me.
See you on camera.
Well, I'm trying out the excellent.
Say hello to all your customers in the Baker's Arms.
Hello to all my customers everywhere, not just the Baker's Arms, all right?
Well, well done. That's absolutely fantastic. Thank you very much. And you're on red wine now as well.
Beautiful.
Wonderful.
Absolutely excellent.
Okay, we're going to cut there while I have a glass of champagne, so we'll just see you in just a minute. Thanks for watching the show. Bye. Well, having a wonderful night here in the Cafe Med, aren't we?
We certainly are. It's bright and sunny, cheery.
Sorry.
Things flowing. And we're doing it all out of a sense of duty to Town TV viewers. We're not having any pleasure at all, are we?
We're not having any pressure at all. It's wonderful. We have wine, champagne, and song.
I've got champagne in my hand.
It's terrible, isn't it? It's terrible. We meet all these famous actors, all these celebrities in the Cafe Met in Salisbury. But what we're going to do now is go into the kitchen and see who we can embarrass in the kitchen, aren't we?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, so follow me to the kitchen. After you.
Well, thank you,
Steve, what are you up to tonight? Say hello to all your friends. Where do you live? In Salisbury?
Just outside Durrington.
Durrington? Look into that lens and say hello to all your friends.
Hello to all my friends in Durrington.
This is a man, Steve, behind the scenes in the machine room of the Cafe Med. So what are you doing tonight?
We've just sort of like sent a lot of canapé stuff and a lot of finger buffet stuff for invited guests and friends and what have you.
Yeah.
And then within about the next 20 minutes we're starting service, so we've got service pretty soon.
You're looking remarkably cool.
Yeah, well.
It's pretty hot in here, isn't it? I'm hot, and we've only been in here 2 minutes.
That's all that champagne you've been drinking.
It's not really champagne.
Go on, I'll say
it's incredibly hot in here.
Yes.
I want to know what you're going to be cooking for tonight.
Right, at the moment we've got lots of different things on the go. We've got braised beef on the go. We've got braised beef.
Braised beef.
Risotto cooking over here.
Yeah.
We've blanched off some butter and onions, ready for a garnish for one dish. And the bits and bobs over there are the last remaining few items of the buffet that we've been sending out. So we've just got those last few bits to go, and then that's it.
Then it's a big gala opening night today. How long has Cafe Med been open?
A week today.
Yeah.
A week today. Yeah.
So you've been really busy.
Very busy. A lot busier than what we thought we'd be.
Yeah.
People have taken it really well.
That's great.
Everyone's coming out and sort of like enjoying the ambience and what have you. So yeah, it's been
fantastic.
Really good.
Steve, thank you very much. Sorry to get crush your kitchen.
No worries.
But we're going to come back in 2 weeks' time and film you cooking us a dish for Town TV, mm-hmm. and we're going to be eating it here on Town TV. Are you going to be here as well?
If you're paying, I'm coming.
Yeah. All right. Okay. All right. Thank you, Steve. We'll see you later.
Okay.
Best of luck. Bye. Bye. Well, thanks for watching us tonight at the Cafe Med. It's been a really, really good evening. It's a wonderful restaurant. And unfortunately, I've lost my presenter. Jason, do you see where Phamie went? You didn't see where Phamie went. No, you did not see. I think she's in there somewhere. She's probably talking to the Richard. So it's either Richard or that tall American guy who's a hunk. But I'm going to... Are you still in here? Are you still here?
Okay. Oh, please don't let me leave. I'm having such a fabulous time.
Come on,
time.
We're going.
No,
we're going. No, we're going to the next. We're going to the next venue. So see you later.
Bye.
Bye. So, thanks for watching this show. Thanks for watching the show.
Yes, thanks for watching.
And
we've had a wonderful time again.
Again, yes.
On the name of art. Of course.
On to the next free bash. Bye.
Bye.
Well, the last time I came down here into this fabulous jewellers was when Olive won her prize, and that was for the VE day. It was a great prize, and Steve made this prize up, which said, never be another one ever again, and Olive has got that. Well done, Olive. Now, there's something happening in here. I said, unfortunately, I believe this wonderful Humphries shop is closing down. So I'm going in to talk to Steve Humphries to find out what's happening then. Right, we're inside Humphries now, and let me introduce you to the Humphries family. When probably everybody in Andover knows them anyway. But this is Rod.
Rod, yeah.
And Eileen.
Yes.
And son Steve.
Hello.
You've seen Steve on the programme when he did that wonderful pennant for, is it a pennant? What have they called it? A brooch. For Olive. Well, what's happening? I hear that there's rumours that you're moving.
Well, my parents have decided they're going to retire at the end of March now, so, yeah, we've decided to close the shop down, and we're all sort of heading off in our separate ways.
So where are you heading for?
I'm actually heading off for Sydney, Australia, so it's a bit of a bigger move than we were planning, because originally I was going to get back up to Birmingham, but...
There's no contest, is there?
Not really. It was a Birmingham-Sydney, Birmingham-Sydney. It was not much of a contest. Since I've got to start again, I might as well try somewhere a bit more exotic. So.
Will you be doing the same in the same business over
yeah,
there?
It'll be the same sort of thing, commissioned jewellery and bits and pieces. We'll see how it goes out there as well.
So. Excellent. Eileen, how long have you been in Andover now, as a business?
As a business, 58 years.
58 years?
I'm not that old. I started 38 years ago.
How long have you been?
My father started 58 years ago there. And so
now, how long have you been in Union Street?
Oh, since 1977, so it's...
Where were you before that?
In Bridge Street, next to the White Hart Hotel.
Oh, were you? In
yes,
Street?
Yeah, yeah.
It's now an art shop now, isn't it? It's a little...
It is, yes. Yeah, I know the one, yeah.
Yeah, that was the original.
So, do you feel any pangs of whatever leaving?
It's very sad, yes, making this final decision.
Yeah, it's sad. I mean, it's nearly 60 years since my father started up there. And basically, I've grown up with it, you know.
And I've been married to it all that time.
You're married into the business, then.
It's a cheap way of keeping staff.
Will you be staying in the area when you retire?
Sure.
Where do you live in Andover? Do you live on the outside?
In the villages, Kingsonborn.
So what are you going to do to keep yourself busy after all this work, hard working life?
Oh, gardening, decorating the house, having a holiday.
Who's going to do the decorating then?
Yes. Yeah, we we're both doing it. It's me that gets most of the paint on me here. When I turn around with a paintbrush.
Well, Stephen, when are you off to Oz?
Probably around about the end of April.
Well, I know you've had very loyal customers over the years. Oh, how many years was it again? 50-odd, however.
Yes, we have. We've had some very good customers and we've made some very good friends. And we'd like to say thank you to them all for their support over these very many years.
Thanks very much indeed. Enjoy your retirement. Have a great time in Australia and keep in touch with us.
I will do, no problems.
Thanks to the Humphries family.
Bye-bye.
Goodbye. Voluminous. What makes it so? More soft, full lashes than you know.
L'Oreal's Voluminous Mascara creates the look. A lot of lashes, not a lot of mascara.
Look into my eyes. What do you see? Mascara? No. Lashes? Oui.
An outstanding lash thickening formula. A deluxe lush brush.
Full lashes, soft lashes, so contrary. Mascara? No. Lashes? Very.
Voluminous Mascara. A lot of lashes from L'Oreal Perfection.
Kellogg's Crunchy Nut Corn Flakes. Delicious. I'll have another bowl.
All right, let's go. Come on,
gotta get out of here. Let's go.
Who's the guy?
You were the guy who hired him.
Kellogg's Crunchy Nut Corn Flakes. The trouble is, they taste too good.
To perform like Linford, you've got to think like Linford. PMA.
PMA.
Positive Mental Attitude.
Come on, it's got to be in here somewhere. Oh, no, my sandwiches.
One big stain, one little Linford, and new generation Persil.
PMA.
Persil performs brilliantly, and it shows.
So what's new about them?
Well, it made them thicker.
And softer.
But why?
We'll be right back.
Kleenex for family tissues. Because they're softer and thicker, we've had to make the box bigger.
Presley, and welcome to another UFO show. We're over actually in the Ring of Avebury at the Red Lion, and I'm going to be speaking to a man called Chris Trubridge. Now, Chris has been doing some work on the whole area, not just Avebury, and he's come up with some really interesting results. Chris, when did you first start onto this? When did you?
We started the project in 1992.
What you're saying is this is the star system as it is today.
Yeah.
And over here is the ground markings of tumuli. And to anybody that doesn't know what tumuli is, it's a little hillock that you see. They're small mounds, aren't
they?
Yeah. And they're dotted all around the countryside here within an 8 mile sort of radius, I suppose.
That's right, yeah.
Now, it's remarkable to me, even as a layman looking at this and don't know too much about the stars, that this map is almost the same as this map. Mm-hmm. So how do you think this was achieved in those days?
That point is very difficult to answer. Mm-hmm. What I can say is that early Britons were not credited at that time with the type of astronomical awareness to produce something of this nature.
Right.
So I think we are looking at some technology which has probably been missed by at some point or another.
You're saying, and I read in the paper yesterday about somebody that was saying that this whole area was probably laid down by Martians. Of course, they were taking the Mickey in certain ways. Mm-hmm. But there is an intelligence, you're saying, more so than the ordinary people that were around at that time?
Well, I think there's a legacy somewhere of technology which was more advanced at the time and perhaps has been realised.
Mm.
As regards Martians, I remain open on that.
I think we all do.
But
when you see that this green mark here...
Yeah. Here we're looking at the constellation of Cygnus, the Swan,
right
in the green area here. That was originally, my starting point was here, Salisbury Hill.
Salisbury Hill?
Yeah, when this project actually first commenced. And I plotted the tumulus, etc., that were in relation directly to that point.
Mm-hmm.
And we found the angulation here, which was the same as Cygni. I think this angle here is probably varying by about 1 to 2 degrees.
Which could possibly happen over the period of
that's right.
4,500 years or more.
Yeah. And what we thought, it was suggested that once I've realised this point here, that you know, if there was any more to this, then we would literally work out all directions on the astronomical chart and see what else would actually fit that outlay. And this is the actual end result. We're looking at a geometry, say, here. We look at the overall pattern of that area there. And we look onto the star chart here. And we find a fairly good representation.
And even you were saying that when you put the tumuli down, all these little tiny dots.
All these tumuli here that don't seem to fit into the plan.
This is the grain marking now.
That's right.
Yeah.
We've realised that this is actually following where the positioning of the Milky Way.
So if we look over here to this one, we should see a string of stars. And
that's
we do.
That's right. And we find the odd bits and pieces that didn't actually fit in.
This is absolutely incredible.
Yeah.
This is even more incredible than actually the gentleman that was saying in the paper about the system of the Sidonia and the Martian likeness to both. It seems, I wonder if anybody has started to work out that the Sidonia map could relate to the stars as well. Because if that was the case, whoever did the Martian one probably did this one.
Yeah.
The layout. Well, in any case, no matter what way we feel, there's 8 miles across here.
Yeah.
It seems remarkable that anybody could actually lay out all these dots. And you were saying something that was interesting about the lottery.
To get 6 numbers on the lottery, you've got a 14 million to 1 chance. So, having said that, I mean, the number of tumuli here, I mean, round about 50, it's the same amount of balls there is in the lottery. The chances of 6 of these points lining up would therefore really be the same sort of odds, 14 million to 1 to get 6 points. You look at it and the...
51 points, so you can just go on, it's like a trillion again.
You know? The sort of numbers that you're talking about are just...
And in
No way could you call this a coincidence.
It must have been laid down by somebody with intelligence, right?
Yeah, when you consider these points, some of the points are literally miles apart, and the fluctuation from the actual celestial map is 1, maybe 2 degrees. It's some of the angles are actually absolutely spot on.
Which would vary in the period of time we're talking about. If this is 4,000 years ago, you know?
It is worth reminding people that the stars as we see them today are not exactly as they would have been back there. Everything is on the move.
This really does need to be put onto a computer because I think it would probably come up that it's even more accurate than what we think. If it was put onto a computer and analysed back through time to find out where the stars were 4,000 years ago, there's a possibility of that, take it.
Well, I've got a computer programme at home which will take us back, which will go back 3,000 years BC, and we're sort of like interested in getting in touch with the author of the software to see whether it's possible for him to take that restriction off so we can take it back a bit further. See if we can't project maybe the chart, and if we can line something up, maybe date, get a roundabout sort of date. It would be also be interesting to see where the planets would have fitted in, maybe with a summer solstice or winter solstice with this map, where the planets would have been in correlation to the stars, and see investigating to see if there's any other markers that may have that may appear, but at the moment don't seem to fit.
It seems incredible to me also that they've just found out about the pyramids and that, which line up, and certain points over there which line up with our stars.
What really needs to be concentrated on is the hard facts. This is the sky at night as it is now. That is a fact. These tumuli are on the ground in these positions. That is a fact. The point that the two charts are so very similar is a fact. All those points are facts. How they fit in with people's personal theories and beliefs, that's really up to the individual person's intelligence and maybe conjecture and guesswork. But the point that we're trying to get across is star chart, fact, tumulo chart, fact. The two match. It's a fact. How, why, who knows?
We really, I feel now, need scientists to start helping, don't we?
Yeah. Well, Chris actually got in touch with the university and was told that it was not really an archaeological discovery, more an astronomical discovery. So he then got in touch with Patrick Moore, who told him the reverse. So really,
there's nobody filling in that gap in the middle.
It's become like a tennis ball being batted backwards and forwards between the two sciences, and no one's really prepared to take it on board because obviously everybody's...
I think they're almost frightened of what they're going to find out.
Afraid of their reputation. I mean, to admit anything would be really to stick your reputation on the line, wouldn't it?
Let's go over to something over here. Now, this is the pictures.
I suppose it was about the same time, 1992. We were cataloguing the stones and just generally going around taking pictures of each stone. Again, really just trying to see if we could see any possible connection with Avebury to this map that we had found on the ground. I mean, we had several possibilities that Avebury, you know, being around the same time period was somehow connected and quite important to it. Mm-hmm. As yet, we haven't really made what we would call a substantial connection there.
This is one of the stones at Avebury.
Mm-hmm.
When we were studying, looking at the picture, it was mentioned that there appeared to be sort of face on the stone, carved into the face of the stone. As you can see, the stone has actually been split. This was done by builders for purposes of getting
walls,
the stone,
yeah,
for actual construction. Mm-hmm. They would build fires against the stone and then throw buckets of water on to cool them quickly and shatter the stones.
Yeah.
So you can see this stone has actually been broken either by builders or other parties at some stage, because of you can see the smooth out exterior here and the rough interior.
Mm-hmm.
And to get a clearer image of how that would actually may have looked, if you actually put the mirror down the split to show what the other part of the stone could well have looked like, you can actually see there quite clearly the eyes and the small nose, which is very reminiscent of the greys,
the alien,
yeah, the alien faces, that
connection, maybe
that's right, yeah. That everybody seems to have been in all fairness, very widely reported. Mm-hmm. Large almond eyes, small nose and mouth.
And strange thing is, this is archaeological stuff that has been found elsewhere in England.
Yeah.
And look at the face again.
Yeah,
here you've got the two big eyes,
mouth. This is actually dug out of a mound.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, there's another mound connection there, but this is very, very hard stone, apparently. And the fact that it's been carved, mm-hmm, to such a similar,
yeah. And when you start looking at that one below it, well, where do we go from here? Where will it all end? This is we're going to take a look around the area as well today. But from us all here, thank you very much for coming and showing us this. We've got to push on with this somehow. So we've got to get it to the right people that can do the work on it. But thank you for coming. And this is Reg Presley saying, watch this space.
Right, welcome to this week's road test. Welcome to the Marcos factory down in Westbury in Wiltshire. I'm with Jeremy Kent. Jeremy, good afternoon.
Hi, good afternoon, Al.
Are you nice and busy?
We certainly are at the moment.
Great.
Yeah, having a great time.
I just love your cars. Look, we're down here in front of this monster. This is the LM500?
That's correct, yeah. The LM500, which is the road-going version of the LM500 race car. That's been racing quite successfully in the UK and also abroad and throughout Europe, Holland especially. And the demand is such that we're having to make road cars for each individual customer specifications as and when they're given to us. So it's taking off quite well.
And do you know what LM stands for? Guess.
Le Mans.
Le Mans. Isn't that wonderful? Isn't that wonderful? Now, look at this. Now, just cast your eyes on that. And Jeremy's going to show me around, aren't you? You're going to show me what's under this monster bonnet. A monster engine, I guess.
Certainly will, I will.
Okay. We're going to look inside. So let's just look at this. Stand out of the way. Stand back amazed while you show me what's going on. Let's open the bonnet up. Because I'm going to be driving this in a minute, which is going to be absolutely amazing. So how do we get this open? The burglar alarms are great on here, by the way. Jeremy, tell me about this monster engine.
Okay, this started life as a Rover V8 engine, which is large enough anyway to power our cars, which are very lightweight. But this has been uprated to a 5-litre engine with 320 brake horsepower,
really?
Which gives it stunning performance. But whilst this is based on a race car, we've got a few creature comforts have been added to make it a little bit more comfortable for road use. For instance, you've got air conditioning, power
really?
Steering.
Yeah.
Also, fully adjustable suspension for hardness and softness of ride, and electronically adjusted pedals, which is a unique feature to Marcos.
Really? So what speed am I going to get out of this, legally?
Legally, of course, 70 miles an hour, but on the racetrack, you'd be looking at getting 165 miles an hour out of this car.
Really? 165? That's incredible. And 0 to 60?
0 to 60 time is just about 4.5 seconds. So take it easy in the snow when you drive it later on today.
Okay. 4.5 seconds. Now, this is the LM500, the Le Mans 500. At Le Mans, you had two LM600s, right? That's and didn't you you won some award there in the pit lane?
That's right. The boys who were working on the in the pits on the cars are the actual guys that we got working here, building the cars for our customers. So they, up against the competition of all the big names in motor racing, won the prize. So it's well deserved and quite a feather in our cap.
Okay. And these are your race colours, is that right?
That's right. This is from our sponsor, Computer Centre.
So a wonderful turnout at Le Mans. So absolutely amazing. So. Are you going to show me a bit inside how to control this beast?
Yes.
All right. So if you go around there, and I'll sit in this side and just have a little look. This is going to be fun. And it's just about to snow, so don't worry.
Jeremy, before I climb in, tell me how to control this.
Okay. As you can see, we've got an array of dashboard panels and switches and dials here. But essentially, the ones you want to use with all the road cars, we've got electric windows, first of all, which are operated by these two switches here. We also have electrically heated and controlled wing mirrors either side, operated by this switch. Coming across the middle here, we've got brake test, rear fog lights, heated front windscreen, which help you demist in this horrible weather we're having at the moment.
That's quite an unusual departure, isn't it, heated front?
That's right. Again, it's something that we've had with most sports cars. You find that when it is cold and damp, you do get a problem with the raked windscreen of the misting up. This cures it entirely.
Well, I'd like to see it on my Peugeot, actually.
Okay, moving along a little bit here, we've got three-speed fan for heating. Also, this car is fitted with air conditioning, so you can have hot or cold air blowing throughout the cabin. Moving on a little bit here, we've got a footwell extractor fan. You get all the hot air that might come through on a hot day from your engine compartment being extracted from the footwell area. This is air conditioning recirculator and air conditioning switch on.
Tell me something about the upholstery. It looks beautiful.
Okay, this is all handmade here at the factory by our department that does all the leather work, carpets, and this is all done on site.
Somebody said you use
Wilton
carpets or not?
We used to use Wilton carpets, being a local company, but they've had a management buyout and we've gone to another type of carpet, but really good quality. So moving on from there, we've got this stack racing instrumentation. This to give you the feel of actually being in a race car. It's exactly the same as the displays that we do have in the race car, and it all comes out on a liquid crystal display, right, as you'll see as you go along.
And some little bird told me you have to actually warm up the tyres. It's like a race car.
Well, it certainly helps, yes. If you're going to put the power down, then wait a little while until the tyres are warmed up, and you'll find you get a little bit more grip out of them.
Well, do you think you're going to trust me with all this monster? Do you think you're going to trust me with the Le Mans 500?
I'm sure you do very well with it.
Okay. Jeremy, your pal, thank you very, very much indeed for loaning it to Tyrone TV, and I'll see you on the open road.
Look forward to it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So, here I go.
There we are.
Here's the keys. Thank you very much.
Enjoy.
Well, this is quite nerve-wracking, really, but we'll see in just a minute. After I put my seatbelts on. Right, here we go. Well, this is the road-going version of the Le Mans 500 Marcos race car. And of all the days we decided to take it for a test drive, it happens to be snowing, so we're not going to be able to really put it through its paces too much. And of course, we've got to obey the 70 mile an hour limit. It's a very rock solid motor car. And I don't really believe it if I told you, you have to let the tyres warm up in true racing tradition before you go roaring off, else you'll find yourself doing pirouettes all up the road. It's got a maximum power output of 320 bhp and a maximum torque of 330 pounds per foot. Acceleration 0 to 60 in 4.5 seconds and a maximum speed, an approximate maximum speed of 170 miles an hour. It's got a fully digital printout. You can
have your speed reading kilometers per hour. I'm looking at the oil temperature now, it's 54 degrees centigrade, oil pressure of 41, and you flip a switch and it'll tell you all sorts of different water temperatures, 76 centigrade, even got fuel pressure. It is one car. It's quite noisy, but you would expect that from a racing car, and slight wind noise, but of course this is a Spider, the convertible version of the Le Mans 500. I'd love to drive it in the sunshine with the roof down. Very tight gearbox, reminds me of Ferrari gate. It's very, very tight. The maximum movement is measured in centimeters, I guess. It's fully equipped with obviously stereo, but it does feel like a racing car, and for almost £50,000, well, you'd expect it. This is wonderful. The funny thing about the Marcos is that you lay flat on your back just about, and your passenger does the same, so it's you're not wedged, but you are beautifully cocooned in this racing shell. If you've got the odd £50,000 to spend, if you win the lottery, don't expect £50,000 worth of comfort, because you won't get that. This is a racing car. The team at Marcos have worked wonders on this car. It's a true British car.
Why do we choose the coldest days of the year in the snow to do a road test, though?
I can't say anything.
Well, you were driving the camera car, you must have been cold.
Yeah, but what was this like?
This is wonderful. Did you see me lose it?
I did.
Yes.
On that snowdrift.
On that snowdrift.
Yeah, I thought you were gone over the ditch.
So did I.
That would have been a bit embarrassing in this, wouldn't it?
Well, £50,000 motor car would have been a bit embarrassing, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
But
it's a lovely looking car, though, isn't it?
It's really great, yeah. I think they've done a great job down in Westbury in Wiltshire to design and build this. I think it's amazing.
Yeah, it is. Excellent. I'd love to have a try. I've got to have a try when they're off camera in case I lose it.
Yeah, okay. have a little go. Have a little sit in there, Tone.
Yeah, I will.
Start it up. Put it in gear. Here we go.
You have to lie down in this.
You have to lie down in it. But I think it's in... Is that in...
I don't know, I'm afraid.
You better put your...
How are you going to start it?
Oh, it's got a secret little thing here. Little doobry, which you do this to. And then you do this, and then it works. And you put, it's like a toy, isn't it? All right,
yeah.
Got your clutch in.
Yeah.
Oh. Don't go through the Danebury Hotel, will you, Tony?
No, if I took my foot off the clutch, I'm straight through that wall. Oh, that's nice. The power of it.
Give a good thrash, come on. It's good, isn't it?
Oh, it's wonderful.
Doesn't that sound nice?
Feeling of power in this.
5 litres, there we are. It's a racing car, as I say, but... anyway, thanks for watching the show. We're going to go back to the studio and get a bit warm. Have a little hot toddy, I think, or two, don't you think so?
What a good idea.
What a good idea. Thanks for watching the show. We'll see you later. Bye, and it's bye from the Le Mans Marcos.
Going shopping? Parking in the old George Mall is an absolute doddle these days. The choice of shops and stores is simply marvellous. With BHS, Marks & Spencer, River Island, Dorothy Perkins, WH Smith, Next, Dixon's, R Price, Mothercare, Boots, Monsoon, Hamels, Jacques Vert and many more. Spring stocks and fashions are arriving daily. So visit the new look Old George Mall Shopping Centre and discover why shopping in Salisbury has never been more enjoyable.
Why fly from Gatwick? Palm Air fly direct from Bournemouth next summer to seven sunny summer destinations, including Malaga, Alicante, Corfu, the Venetian Riviera, the Algarve, Menorca and Mallorca, also from Southampton Airport. See your travel agent soon and ask for the Palm Air brochure and fly the Palm Air Flight 9 Whisper Jet.
Okay, BJ, it's time to go.
See you at the airport.
Welcome to this week's sports show. I'm Roger Smith. Before we read the sports results out, we've got a couple of things to mention. The first thing is a darts exhibition. This will be held at the Swallow Pub. The World Embassy World Champion Steve Beaton, he's coming down to the Swallow on the 6th of April to play an exhibition match against eight people. Now, to get the eight people, obviously everybody can't play them, so they've got like a knockout competition, which is going to be held on the 23rd of March, which is a Saturday, at the Swallow, and it starts at 7:30. So if anybody was interested in darts and they want to have a go playing Steve Beaton, there's a knockout competition. You can phone Kevin or Heather on Andover 359 769 and they'll help you with any inquiries you want or tell you all about it, what time to start. If you do turn up on the night, turn up a little bit before 7:30 so they can enter you into the competition. Okay, the next one we've got is, as you can see, I'm wearing a Leeds United centenary top. It's a football top. It was donated by Dave Willis of Street Trend and Union Street, Andover. And what he'll be doing in the next coming weeks, he's going to be giving a little prize each week. So we'll ask a sports question. It doesn't have to be football. We'll ask all sorts of questions. You phone in 390 390. Ask for me or Chrissy. Leave the answer to the question. And, well, we're kicking off with a football tip. So you can actually win a football top this week. It's a good top. As you can see, it's a limited edition. So that's nice of Dave. To start off the quiz, we're going to ask a pretty simple question. Well, it's supposed to be simple. Leeds is at the end of a very famous motorway. We want to know the name of that motorway. And we've got three choices. Is it the M25, the M3, or the M1? So just one of them is the right one, obviously. Phone in or write in and give us your answer. And you could win this lot. If you're selected at the Golden Bucket, you could win one of these lovely Leeds United tops. So on with foot results. Here's the foot results for the 2nd of March. In the Beza Homes League, Salisbury 1, Cambridge 0. Good home win there for Salisbury. In the Juice and Wessex League, Totten 0, Thatcham 2. Bournemouth 1, Andover 2. Good away win there for Andover. Downton 0, Ryde 2. Petersfield 1, Bemerton Heath 3. Good away win there for Bemerton. In the Club Sabre Hampshire Division 1, Itchinswell 1, Overton 0. New Street 0, Fleetlands 3. Bit disappointing there for New Street. Romsey 2, Horndean 1. Good home win there for Romsey. The league standings in the Beza Homes Premier Division. Salisbury are currently 14th. They've played 27 games and have got 36 points. In the Juice and Wessex League, Andover are 5th. They've played 31 games and have got 54 points. Bemerton are 9th, they've played 28 games and got 43 points. Downton are 11th, they've played 31 games and got 40 points. Whitchurch are 13th, they've played 27 games and got 35 points. Totten are 15th, they've played 29 games and got 33 points. The Club Sabre Hampshire Division 1, New Street are 4th, they've played 23 games and got 46 points. Romsey are 6th. They've played 20 games and got 40 points. Overton, they've slipped down to 18th. They've played 23 games and they've got 21 points. Thanks for watching the show. Phone in with a quiz. There'll be plenty of other quiz questions in the next coming weeks. Phone in, write in, and we'll see you next week. Bye-bye for now.
Hello, I'm Ben Wilson with a roundup of the weekly news from your local newspaper, the Andover Advertiser. Lee's story of the week concerns frightening news that some Andover teenagers are turning to prostitution and theft to support their heroin habits. The town's heroin problem is claimed to be so bad that it has been dubbed Smack City. John Lutton from the Dale Trust said, "For its size, Andover is a huge problem. The people we're seeing are getting younger and younger." A soldier who terrorised late-night shoppers and garages in Andover, Tidworth and Barton Stacey began a 12-year prison sentence last Friday. Lance Corporal David Doody, who'd had associations with Tidworth Garrison, fired between the heads of two women workers at Charlton's one-stop shop. Sentencing Doody on 6 counts of robbery and 6 weapon charges, the judge called it a reign of terror. Bored youngsters could have an alternative to mooching on street corners. Test Valley Borough Council are investigating reopening the Winchester Road drop-in centre to the whole community. The centre was closed in November last year when Hampshire County Council withdrew youth workers. Firefighters from Andover are taking up an amazing charity challenge to climb the 3 highest mountains in Great Britain within 24 hours. Money raised will be split between the Centre for Injured Firefighters and the Spinal Injuries Unit at Oddstock Hospital. The event takes in Ben Nevis in Scotland, Scaffold Pike in England, and Snowdon in Wales. Have you seen this bear? 4-year-old Maisie Jane Harris hopes the answer is yes, because beloved Biddy Bear has gone missing. Maisie was inseparable from Biddy until he was lost somewhere near Vigo Road Infant School. The search is now on for the missing bear, and anyone who can reunite the two friends should contact the Andover Advertising newsroom on 323 456. Andover could soon provide new leisure, creative and educational activities for retired people. National Association, the University of the Third Age, is holding a meeting at the Museum of the Iron Age to discuss the possibility of forming a branch in Andover. Contact Andover and District Age Concern on 354425 for more details. And finally, Vice Chairman of New Street Football Club, Jim Dunn, has had his 35-year-old beard axed and head shaven. The brave act made a hair-raising £350 for the club's trip to America. All these stories and more will appear in this week's Andover Advertiser. I'm Ben Wilson reporting.
We're down in the Hampshire County Council offices, and again, we were here a few weeks ago doing the letters from Handel, if you remember. And with me today is Tim Greenwood. And Tim is the County Planning Officer.
That's correct, yes.
Thanks for inviting us here today, Tim.
My pleasure.
What's the main thing that stuck out? I know you laughed when we saw this, but there was something on the news item we got about dormice.
Yes, the County Council considered a report from me 10 days ago about biodiversity, and a major report has recently been published which follows on from the famous Rio summit of 2 or 3 years ago. Increasingly people are recognising the importance of biodiversity, and that's really the issue of the range of species that we have in our community and environment, and the value that they bring to our environment, and the need to make sure that we retain a wide range of species. And dormouse cropped up because we identified it as one of the species which is in decline in Hampshire. And one of my councillors homed in on this in particular, and it attracted the news headlines.
Are there many species that's in decline here?
There are several species which are in decline in Hampshire. I actually have a list of them here, and some of them are ones which obviously people will be familiar with. The water vole is another, and the brown hare, and then there are things like skylarks and woodlarks and bitterns, and then in the heathland areas of the county there are things like sand lizards, and the great crested newt is another reptile and amphibian which is under threat. Equally, there are butterflies which are under threat. And the important thing is that action needs to be taken, really, to encourage these species to thrive and prosper in the future. And dormouse is just one of the many that there are both locally and nationally.
Well, your brief must be huge because you're chief the county planning officer. But that encompasses wildlife as well.
Yes, it does. My duties range from seeking to identify how many houses need to be built in Hampshire over the next 10 to 15 years, right down to conserving areas of our environment to make sure that threatened species thrive and prosper in the future.
We're not too badly off in Hampshire, really, for woodlands, are we?
Woodlands are fairly well represented in Hampshire compared to some other parts of the country. But the problem that we do have is that they're not necessarily all well managed, and we have a number of projects where we seek to work with landowners to help them bring back into management some of the neglected coppice, which is valuable for wildlife, and also offers an opportunity for new products as well.
Do you give grants to these people that when for tree planting and things like that?
Yes, the County Council does offer grants for both new planting and for management purposes. And we also offer an advisory service to landowners as well.
Now, your advice was taken by the government. Well, what action will be pursued by that?
Well, I think the government's taking very seriously the issue of biodiversity. I hear quite frequently the Secretary of State for the Environment on the national news talking about it, and it's something that seems to be reasonably high on the government agenda, and I think that's right.
Yeah. Is the tree planting programme going according to the way you've planned it?
Well, the government, interestingly, in a document which was published last autumn, set out quite an ambitious target for new tree planting in this country. I can't remember precisely the figures, but it was suggested increasing the tree cover from the current level of say about 10% to perhaps 20% in the next half century. So there is a very ambitious target of being proposed by the government. Whether or not that will succeed, only time will tell.
Well, if these are the corpses and the tree planting goes very well, these species, will they won't be endangered anymore? Is this the whole plan to do the things?
Well, I think it'll take more than tree planting to help some of these species, because indeed some of the species which are under threat in Hampshire thrive on in open areas. So it's a question of finding the right balance, I think, between the various land uses and making sure that there are the appropriate habitats for all the different types of species which are under threat, because some of them are amphibians, so it's important that our riverbanks are properly managed. I think I would like to make a point actually about that we must be careful as a society not to make areas too tidy. As I understand it, one of the problems with, say, the water vole, which is a species which is in decline in some areas, is the fact that riverbanks have been tidied up so much that there's fewer opportunities for them to live and operate in those conditions.
I know one of your other roles is waste disposal and things like that. I know it's an awful one to have to deal with, and you must have nightmares about that particular one.
Well, I sometimes have to put on my flak jacket, because clearly dealing with minerals and waste is not popular with the public, but it's society which causes the demand for minerals, and it's society which creates the waste. waste has to be disposed of ultimately, and people, generally speaking, don't like waste disposal operations in their vicinity. Great efforts are being made to try to encourage recycling and reuse, but regrettably there still remains waste that has to be disposed of eventually, and some of that finds its way into landfills, which people don't like, and some of it goes to incineration, which people don't like. It's a problem for all of us. I have the unenviable task of making recommendations and giving advice as to how we should actually deal with waste and where it should be finally disposed of.
Tim, thanks very much for talking to us today. Will it be okay if we come in from time to time and find out how this whole thing is progressing?
Of course.
Thanks a lot.
At County Flowers, we have a wide range of dried and fresh flowers and plants, especially for Mother's Day. We have a local, national and international delivery service, and for Mothering Sunday, we will be providing a free local delivery service to all our customers. Our bouquets, baskets, plants and other gift items are at very affordable prices. At County Flowers, you will always be welcomed with a smile from our friendly and courteous staff, who are always willing to help whatever the occasion. Visit us at County Flowers, the Chantry Centre, Andover, or telephone us with your visa or access on Andover 345 605.
The Christchurch Ski and Leisure Centre. If you're an experienced skier and like to keep in trim, or have never skied before and want quality tuition, the Ski and Leisure Centre is the place to go. The ski shop stocks all the latest fashions and a workshop to keep your skis in tip-top condition. From children's parties to company bookings, phone the Christchurch Ski and Leisure Centre on 01202 499 155 or fax 01202 483 564. Do you have a problem with damp and condensation? You may not be aware that the problems are caused by everyday living, cooking, taking a bath or shower, drying your hair, and even breathing. How is the problem solved? The Mega Dry Dehumidifier, a condensation collecting machine. It attracts the moisture throughout your home and holds it in a container, so you can pour your condensation problems down the drain.
I'm Reagan Beale, welcome to the newsroom of the Salisbury Journal. Plans to stage a rock concert as part of this year's Salisbury Festival have collapsed following objections from the police. Organisers had spent months planning the event with the hope it would take place at Salisbury Racecourse in May, but police objected to efforts to get a public licence to hold the concert. They said they were unhappy on a number of grounds, including the lack of car parking and absence of plans for an emergency access. James Pratt, the White Parish garage owner shot in the hand when he tried to disarm a robber, has been awarded £100 for his bravery by a judge at Winchester Crown Court. The award came as the judge jailed Lance Corporal David Doody for 12 years for carrying out a series of armed raids in Wiltshire and Hampshire last year. 27-year-old Doody, a soldier with the Princess of Wales Royal Regiment at Canterbury, who'd previously been based in Bulford and Tidworth, admitted 6 counts of robbery and weapon charges. The Airman's Cross Memorial, which usually stands near the village of Shrewton on Salisbury Plain, has been taken away to be cleaned and restored. The memorial was funded by comrades of 2 flying pioneers who died when the plane they were testing crashed nearby. The refurbished memorial will be rededicated on July the 5th, exactly 84 years after their plane came down. A woman cashier was left shaken after a hooded robber with a large carving knife held up a Salisbury petrol station. She was alone in the New Sarum service station in Southampton Road when the man threatened her with a weapon and grabbed money from the till. He also snatched the tape from the garage's security video, capturing him in action. And at Coombe Bissett, the village post office and shop was forced to close for repairs after it was badly damaged during a break-in. Intruders smashed through a counter to get at a safe containing several £1,000, postal orders and stamps. Police have not ruled out a possible link with a spate of post office break-ins 2 years ago when a string of rural offices in Wiltshire, Dorset and Hampshire were hit. 2 men accused of the murder of Salisbury teenager Edward Harkins at the city's funfair pleaded not guilty when they appeared at Winchester Crown Court. Justin Rainey of Glyndebourne Close, Salisbury, and Timothy Kerwin of Elmgrove Road, Salisbury, both aged 23, are accused of the murder of 18-year-old Edward on October the 21st. They were both remanded in custody. Their trial has been provisionally fixed for June the 24th and is expected to last for 3 weeks. Human bones unearthed in a Salisbury garden are thought to date from Roman times. The remains, discovered by a builder digging out a patio at a policeman's home in Downsway, could be more than 1,900 years old. Archaeologists were called in when a skull, including a jawbone with teeth, was found. Sports news. Godolphin School athlete Camilla Waite turned in an excellent performance at the English school's cross-country championships, finishing 10th in the intermediate girls' race. She has now been picked to represent England in the forthcoming Home Countries International, being held in Scotland. And finally, demolition work at the old Salisbury Infirmary site has provided a new view of the city's most famous landmark. The multi-million pound development now taking place at the old hospital includes new houses and flats and two shops. The whole site should be complete by April of next year. I'm Regan Beale. Thank you very much for watching the Salisbury Journal News Review.
You know when you cook a curry at home, you think you put everything in there, and it never quite tastes the same as when you go to an Indian restaurant. Now, I don't know whether we're going to get a chance of finding out, but we're going into the curry garden here in Union Street in Andover, and maybe they might show us what sort of ingredient goes into this wonderful, well, one of my favourite dishes of the lot. So let's see if we can have a chat with somebody in here. Right, I've had many a good meal here in the curry garden, which is in, as I said before, Union Street. But I've never really spoken to the guys very much because they're always too busy when I come in here. But we caught them at an early point in lunchtime and they've got a bit of time, so we're going to have a chat and maybe later on find out what goes into your curry. How are you, Faisal?
Not bad, thanks. How about yourself?
I'm pretty good. And Shalu?
Yeah, I'm all fine, thank you.
How's business?
Business is okay at the moment, not bad. Picking up as we go on.
Okay. Right, now you're talking about doing like a lunchtime menu for businessmen. Is this something that you're going to do in the future or the near future?
Probably in about a couple of weeks. Because at the moment, we don't get many customers at lunchtime, you see. Yeah. So if you do that, we'll probably get more customers. Sometimes we get lots of booking coming in, so I do this special sort of menu. So what you suggest, well, I'll give you like a bottle of wine or something. Mm-hmm. Or if you stick some papadums in, things like that.
Yeah. How long have you been here now?
Me, roughly about 4 months now. Yeah. He's been here for a long time.
Yeah, I've been here 6 months now. And I was here before,
Yeah, so you're used to Andover now?
Used to Andover, yeah. Loads.
How do you find Andover?
Quite. It's nice, it's quiet.
Where are you from London, yeah.
Yeah, come back to London, it's quiet, but we like it, no problem.
Yeah, were you working in a restaurant up in London?
Yeah, I was working up London, restaurant as well, and I worked up East Sussex, yeah. Near Brighton. It's really nice, yeah. So I worked all over.
Yeah, but Andover's quiet. Isn't it nice to be quiet every now and then?
Not really, but when you're used to that London atmosphere, like Oxford Street, things like that, you think, oh, well, mate, you know, it's all quiet.
Yeah, I know.
And it's fine, different for us.
It takes a while to adjust to it, but
we're
all right,
you know. It's all right for us. We got to know everyone in Andover now, so it's okay.
Well, in this business, you do get to know an awful lot of people. Of course, and the regulars, obviously.
Yeah, regulars. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it's a lot of socialising also. Yeah. You know, you get to know people, then you meet up with them, go to clubs and things. It's really nice. So, I mean, we do enjoy our job.
Okay. Now, we're going to get... you're going to cook us a meal, I hope.
Yeah. How about a meatfall, yeah?
A what?
A meatfall, which is the extremely hot one.
Oh, no, I don't think I can handle that. Well, I'm normally a Madras man myself.
Yeah, that's fairly hot, so you should be all right.
I've come down from Vindaloo. That used to be the one, but... it turned my hair white.
Do the same.
What's the chef's name here?
Kabir.
Kabir.
And he's going to show us what goes in
there. A nice mild curry and a spicy curry.
Right.
So you get to see what they put in there.
Yeah.
All the spices, you know.
Yeah.
Well, you always think when you're at home that you're doing everything right, and you think, I'm going to have a wonderful curry here, I'm going to cook this. It never turns out the same as when you come in here. Does it?
It doesn't, no. If I try to cook a chicken tikka masala at home, it won't turn the same. But if you go in the restaurant, I don't know what the chef does to the curry. Just so much difference.
That's why he's a chef and I'm standing here in front of a television camera. Can we go into the kitchen and meet him?
Sure. Yeah, anyway.
Right, this is Kabin, the chef, and he's going to explain to us all what are you cooking for a start?
chicken tikka masala.
Oh, I love it. So, can you explain to us what you're doing as you're doing it?
Okay, this is mixed powder, some sugar, fungal leaves, this pyogi, which is like butter, coconut powder.
Coconut powder?
That's right, yeah. And almond powder. Turmeric powder.
There's not very much curry powder in that, is
there? Nah, chicken dings, so I don't put much spices.
Right.
Like in vindaloo, we put more spices.
Oh, I see, yeah.
That's right.
Now, what's this? This is all pre-made, you've already done it.
Gravy.
Gravy, yeah.
That's right.
It's all getting stirred up now.
Right.
This is beginning to smell really, really good now.
Right.
That's getting all stirred up as well.
Now we're going to put chicken. Where's the chicken here?
Right, this chicken has been cooked before, hasn't it?
That's right, yeah, in tandoori.
In the tandoori,
that's
yeah.
Right. 7 pieces for one portion.
7 pieces of chicken for
that's
one
right,
portion?
For one portion. And this is the cream.
Oh, this is looking really good. How long does it take you to actually make this up?
About 5 minutes.
Yeah?
That's right, yeah.
But then again, you have to cook the chicken for a long time before that.
Yeah.
That's the coriander being cut up.
That's right, yeah.
I'm sorry, we did catch you a bit on the hop by popping in like this, and we do appreciate you doing it this such short notice.
Thank you, it's all right. Now it's ready to serve.
That's ready now?
Yeah, it's cooked.
Jay, you've been hungry?
Hmm.
Hmm, so am I. Here we go. We're going to eat this in a minute, yeah? Now, doesn't that look a picture? Why can't I do that? Irish stew is about the only thing I can do.
Cashew nut and sliced almond. Some more curry on the top.
Mm-hmm.
There's a cream.
Yeah. More cream on it?
That's right. For decoration. This is it.
Now, isn't that a picture? Isn't that beautiful?
And it's ready for serve.
Wonderful.
Which is, we call it metipata. And the POV again.
That's the buttery stuff again.
That's right, yeah. This is gonna be medium. I'll put the chicken. Seven pieces.
Right. So you always put the same portion
right.
In there?
That's right.
More gravy. Yeah, is there any spices in the gravy then?
Yes, we put
already pre-spiced
turmeric,
it.
Yeah, the turmeric powder, yeah. Zira powder, and dhania powder, and chili, coconut. That's it.
Do you use the same gravy for most of them? Is it just depends on what you do on other ingredients?
No, we use gravy in every curry. The gravy is made of same ingredients. Every curry.
If somebody wanted the vindaloo, it gets more spices in it.
Yeah, that's right. Well, then we made it in the vindaloo, like put more chili.
Oh, more chili, yeah.
That's right, yeah. Like we put less chili in Madras.
Yeah.
So,
thank you. That's coriander in there again.
That's right, coriander. Makes the curry more flavour, more tasty. Smells nice.
It does, gives it a lovely aroma, doesn't it? What is this dish you're doing now at the moment?
Chicken harai.
Harai?
That's right, chicken harai. It serves in iron harai. This is called harai.
That's what that's the dish itself?
The dish. We serve it in this one. And so at the bottom goes a wooden thing. That's it.
Oh,
that's
I see. Yeah.
That's why it's called chicken harai.
Right.
It's got hot again. With some curry on the top.
Look at this, isn't this a picture? That's fabulous.
I'm making a bomba patati.
Oh, this is a side dish?
Oh, yeah, side dish. And the oil goes to every dish.
Yeah.
Cut it into small pieces.
So I would say on a Saturday, Friday, or Saturday night, it's frantic in this kitchen, is it?
Oh, it's very busy.
You never stop, do you?
No, until 12 o'clock.
Until 12?
That's right. Put some gravy.
You must make an awful lot of gravy in here. How long does it take to make all that?
We're making in the daytime, look. This is the gravy.
Oh, I see. This is what you're doing.
It takes about 2 to 3 hours to make it every day. Salt, mixed powder, fan leaves, and the ghee, which is the butter.
You don't use very much of the butter, do you?
No, it's a little bit. So you make it curry. Flavour and tasty.
Yeah.
And some slightly hot. Goes to Bombay Ali.
You put coriander in everything then, I take it?
Only not in korma, yeah. And chicken pasanda and moglai.
Right, okay.
This is a free dish. We don't put coriander on it.
Where do you get most of your ingredients from? Do you have to get them from London? Or
from
can you get
London, that's right. We get it from London, and the Londoners get it from our country, which is in Bangladesh or in India.
Oh, this is potatoes?
That's right, yeah.
And what did you cook there, man? Just butter?
Pardon?
How did you cook these? Just boiled, are they?
Yes, boiled. One portion.
What a big portion for a side dish, isn't it?
Yeah. More gravy.
Your coriander seems to be very popular in this kitchen, doesn't it?
Aye.
It's ready now.
Nearly, but it's not hot yet. Want to get out now and put it in the package.
What's the difference between ordinary boiled rice and pilau rice?
Boiled rice, just it's been boiled,
yeah.
Like potato. And the pilau rice is not boiled. Pilau rice we cooked is ghee. We put this ghee and we put another butter and cardamom, cinnamon.
Oh, this all goes into the pilau rice.
Goes to pilau rice, that's right, and cinnamon. Pilau rice tasted than plain rice.
Yeah. Oh, it's a lot tastier, isn't it?
This is a difference.
Right, we're ready to go. Well, thanks for cooking that for us.
Thank you very much.
Can we come and see you again and get a few more recipes from you?
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I never do know what the etiquette is, whether you should plonk all your rice on the plate and then plunk your food on top of it. I'll put it all in little pieces. I'm going to do it in little pieces at the moment because it's lunchtime. Don't know how hungry I am yet, but it smells great. Right, you can turn that off now and sit down and have some of this. Come on, Jake.
Achieve my dream. I'm not going to give it up that easy.
Now, a new date with destiny.
He's Mike Tyson. He's got that sort of like awe around him.
7 years between fights.
I rocked him off, lifted him off his feet.
He hit him with a hard punch.
And a lot has changed.
I'm the champion. And I've seen myself spectacularly knocking him out.
If I have to give him another choice, I'd beat him.
I refuse.
Live from Las Vegas in the early hours of Sunday morning on March the 17th, a fight to make British sporting history.
There's no way he's going to beat me. No way. No way. No way.
Sky subscribers can see the big fight by ordering now on 0990 800 800. That's 0990 800 800. Book now and receive a £5 discount. Cable viewers order through your local operator.
The Flora London Marathon has chosen the British Heart Foundation as an official charity. One way we aim to help them meet their £2 million target is our Marathon Miles promotion. Simply by sending in the special lids, everybody can do their bit to help keep the British Heart Foundation fighting heart disease. Everybody. Flora, for everybody.
Curry with Murray.
I know, it was delicious.
Who thought of that?
Jason, I
Did
think.
He? Oh, Ruby. Jason.
Ruby Murray.
Was it really good?
That was excellent. Really good. Some of the stuff, I normally go and I'll have a madras. Mm-hmm. But there was all these different ones, so I'm going to have to think about it now when I go into an Indian restaurant. But
I don't know much about curries. I thought they had a shop in the high street. Okay. Yes. Oh, dear, right. Yeah. Enough of this humour. You've all been waiting to know who's won the dehumidifier and the £50 worth of clothing from Street Trend, haven't you? And we're going to tell you in a minute, because we're going to do the draw in the old golden bucket.
Good prize this week, because it was a rollover, so we have a...
It's a rollover.
It's a big prize for those two.
Better than the lottery on Town TV.
Of course it is.
I hope you enjoyed Roger's little quiz too, so don't forget to ring in for that one. Anyway, shall I plunge my hand in?
Go on, you do that.
Oh, there we go.
Do the honours.
Who's going to win this? This is £250 worth, is this? Let's see who's won this one. Hang on. Can you read that, Tone? Looks like Adrian Stevens. Adrian Stevens, you won the dehumidifier, and you won the £50 worth of clothing from Street Trends. So that's fantastic. Well done. Big applause for Adrian. Right. Oh, and the answers were, of course, D was for David Bowie, D was for Donald or Daffy Duck, and D was for duet or duo.
Really so difficult stuff, wasn't it?
That was really...
Somebody phoned in and they said, I was up all night trying to think of the answers to that. Well, well done, you got them anyway.
Probably Bill, wasn't it? Yeah. Right, before we go into the next prize, which is all about boxing, because we've got the big fight coming up next week, we're going to cut to Gary Shaw from Comtel, who's come down to the studio to tell you all about it. So over to you, Gary.
Thanks, Al, for that intro. Well, next Sunday, March the 17th, in the early hours of the morning, going out at about 2 a.m, is the first ever pay-per-view boxing match available in the UK. Obviously, everybody knows who it is. It's the Mike Tyson versus the heavyweight champion of the world, and will continue to be the heavyweight champion of the world, I hope, our Frank Bruno. Now, it is actually available on our network, and it is going out on Channel 47, which is Sky Sports 2 channel. You don't have, however, to be a subscriber to Sky Sports to get the fight, to view the fight. What you have to do is ring into our customer services, and if you book the fight before midnight next Friday, it'll only cost you £9.95. If you ring in on the Saturday at the last minute, it'll cost you £14.95. So, book early. And now, back to the quiz.
Well, I hope you're all going to watch the big fight. Let's hope Frank wins.
Yeah. What's the chances of that?
You wait and see. Frank was going to do that. We've got some great prizes this week for our boxing competition. We've got a super clock radio from Dixon's in Salisbury. That's right.
And the old George Mill there.
Yeah. And thanks to the old George Mill. And we've got a sweater. Where's that from, Tone?
That's from the sweater shop, also in the old George Mill.
Yeah, very expensive. It's probably worth £100, those two put together.
Yeah, there's a lovely sweater.
Fantastic sweater. Yeah, it's a boxing, three boxing questions, and they're all relatively easy if you know anything about boxing. R. Henry. Do you remember R. Henry?
Oh, R. Henry. Splash it all over.
He knocked out Muhammad Ali, didn't he?
He did, yeah. Just for a short while.
Well, he knocked him down anyway. What was R. Henry's first name?
Second name.
I mean, second name. What's R. Henry's second name? He was a super guy.
He was.
It was a clue, wasn't it?
He is.
R. Henry's surname. Mr. Bugner is 46 now, and he lives in Australia, but he's fighting again, I think, next week, isn't he?
Yeah, in
Germany.
Yeah. Let's hope for us all yet.
That's right. Mr. Frazier had the first Christian name as well. So what is Mr. Bugner's Christian name? There we are. That's the second question. Third question. And what was Muhammad Ali's name before he changed it?
Before he went religious.
So there we are. What's R. Henry's surname? Mr. Bugner's Christian name. And what was Muhammad Ali's name before he changed it? And you can win... It's worth £100. A clock radio from Dixon's and a wonderful sweater from the sweater shop in Salisbury. Great. Thanks for watching the show. Don't forget it's Mothering Sunday on the 17th. That's going to be great. And St. Patrick's Day, isn't it?
St. Patrick's Day.
Yeah, you were in Ireland last year, weren't you?
Yeah, I had a camera crew over there last year. Remember, it was good fun.
So
yeah.
Don't forget that. If you want to go on the graphic channel for Mothering Sunday, just ring up now. So don't forget to ring us on all those quizzes and questions and anything else you want to do on Andover 390.
390.
Or Salisbury 555.
222.
Jason's grinning away, isn't he? Because he knows a little caption's going to come up right here. Isn't that right, Jace? And the fax number is Andover 390.
391.
Or you can write to us at P.O. Box 555 Andover. And don't forget to book us for the road show.
Yes, it's going to be a great summer this time. I'm looking forward to this.
It's going to be a great summer. Anyway, it's Formula One motor racing again. And we're going to bring you something we shot a few years ago with Nick Mason from Pink Floyd, name dropping again.
Yes.
And with the Tyrrell Formula One team over in Detroit. So I hope you enjoy that. And keep on watching Town TV. All these supercars coming. We've got Ferraris, we've got Aston Martins, and all that sort of stuff. So bye for now. Thanks for watching the show.
Yeah. Bye, folks.
Bye.